Orion presents The Girls Inside, written by NJ Mackay, read by Emma Jane Goodwin.
Prologue.
She takes one last hungry look at her daughter. There is something almost unnervingly perfect about a sleeping child. Watching her lying there, her breath soft and even, eyelashes fanned across her plump cheeks, spikes a pain through her heart that is so terrible, so vivid and real, that it is physical. It is heartache beyond anything. A long, excruciating chasm that leaves her surprised she is still standing. It is the type of pain that fells you. She goes closer to the bed, allowing herself these last precious moments. She bends, kneeling next to the girl, and inhales. The sweet smell of her strawberry shampoo and lavender bubble bath. The slightly musty odour of the soft toys, piled high, which likely need washing. She presses her lips to her daughter's forehead, almost wishing she would wake and demand that her mother stay as she had so many times before. But not tonight. Tonight she doesn't even stir. The woman moves downstairs and pops cash in an envelope for the sitter. She writes the girl's name on it, Jennifer, in shaky scrawl and yells goodbye to her. Then she steps out into the night. She ignores her car, walking briskly down the road, forcing her feet to move, one in front of the other. She knows too well that if she stops, even for a second, she might not be able to keep going. Half a mile on, she reaches the postbox at the end of Pickett Lane. She takes the envelopes from her bag, sliding one inside the other, reading the name printed in her own neat lettering, and she knows, just knows, that the recipient won't let her down. A panic thought rises in her mind just for a moment. Will she ever see her child again? But she pushes it away. Too late for that now. Too late to change her mind. She walks on and on. She gets to the little shed in the sprawling allotment, a place familiar to her. She has knelt there many times, hands in the earth, mud and leaves prickling her bare knees, telling her child which seeds to plant and where. A little slice of the outdoors in the city. She goes into the shed, which she spent the week emptying, moving their things to the garage at the house. Everything she left earlier is still here now. Everything she needs to do this. To carry out her plan to its bitter end. She takes a can of petrol and pours it liberally over every surface of the shed, every wooden panel. Then she gets the box of long matches, strikes one, and the flames fly. Her last thought before the angry fire consumes the building and everything in it is of her daughter, her precious girl. The offices are hidden down back streets and housed in a tall, shiny building. Parsons and Rice occupy the entire first floor. I head up the stairs and sit awkwardly, feeling out of place, in the reception area, which is just a cordoned-off part of the large open-plan space. There are rows of people, heads down, huddling over their keyboards. The receptionist, who saw me in with a, "Can I get you a drink?" is sitting clacking away, fingers flying over the keys. She is the only person I can see with a desk of her own, separate from the other banks housing many occupants. A tall, fair-haired man comes over after what seems like ages, though can really only have been seconds, and looks at me with a slight head tilt. It's an expression I've seen before, one of sympathy. "Blue Solito?" "Yes," I say, standing. He grins, broad and disingenuous. "What an unusual name." I smile thinly. It's the one I was given. He nods as though he understands entirely, which obviously he doesn't. I get this all the time, of course. Who the hell names their daughter Blue, after all? My mother was a hippie, I suppose. My memories of my very young years are of the sweet smell of dope smoke and patchouli, and whimsical music played on scratch records. A woman like that would think nothing of calling a child after a favourite album. She told me it was either Blue or Ocean. I'm not sure Ocean would have been any better. "Follow me." And I do. through the warren of people, out into a set of rooms that still offers little privacy because of the glass doors. But he ushers me into one of them and sits behind a large desk, gesturing for me to take the chair opposite. He frowns and asks, "Were you offered a drink?" I'm not thirsty. I'm starting to feel annoyed now. I glance at my wristwatch pointedly. For all he knows, I could have a myriad of places to be. He says, "Firstly, thank you so much for coming in. I do appreciate your time." I blink, don't say anything, wondering if he will ever get to the bloody point. I could have discussed matters over the phone, but I really felt it would be better to meet in person. And when I spoke to the police, they thought, well, the police? All I'd had was his secretary calling to summon me to his office for a delicate matter that needed to be dealt with in person. It's not every day a solicitor's office calls. I thought about not turning up at all, but curiosity got the better of me. But now, the mention of law enforcement makes my palms dampen. I press them against my thighs. "I have no idea what you're talking about," I say. He sighs. "Perhaps it ought to have been them." I snap, "Can you just tell me what's going on?" Natasha Dryden. My eyes drop down to the floor. No carpet, just floorboards, or perhaps some sort of linoleum made to look like wood. I scrape the end of my steel toe-cap boot across it, looking for a groove or an edge. Definitely linoleum. Awful stuff. Real floorboards are lovely. The first thing I did when I bought my flat was rip up the carpets in the room that still had them, by that point musty and dense. The master bedroom had been bare when I looked around, and I'd seen the original beautiful floor. I knew it was under there. I sanded the entire flat myself. A labour of love. Now every time I walk through my place barefoot, I feel immense satisfaction. My flat comprises the top two floors of a converted Victorian house, which would have been grand and sprawling in its heyday. Hidden away inside its walls were lots of original features that others had tried to cover up, but which I dug out diligently like buried treasure. He says, "Miss Silito." "Blue is fine." "Blue then, and please call me Matthew." I look up and meet his eyes. "She's dead?" He nods, suitably somber. A rushing sound starts up in my ears, a sort of explosive whoosh, then a faint crackling. Fire has its own sounds that once heard can never be forgotten. It is a vast and engulfing physical thing with a soundtrack, fizzing and popping. You can describe it in actions too. Flames lick, smoke rises, embedding itself wherever it can, getting into things like lungs. I suddenly feel very faint and lean forward, resting my head in my hands. Pushing the wheelchair backwards, my feet rubbing along the awful, not tiled, pretend floors. He murmurs, "This must be a terrible shock." I tell him, "I haven't spoken to her in 20 years. He nods, but nothing about him denotes empathy. Each move practiced and, to my mind, insincere. I'm probably being unfair, of course. This can't be an easy task. I look up at him. "How did she..." I pause. "You mentioned police." The nod again. Grave this time. "In very sad circumstances, I'm sorry to tell you that Natasha Dryden took her own life." That sound. A fizz, a crackle. Like some demented version of that cereal advert, snap, crackle and pop. I almost laugh, feel my mouth misbehaving. I clamp my hand to my lips. "Can I have some water, actually?" "Of course." He seems glad for the excuse to leave. Natasha. Brave. Fierce. Bold. Suicidal? It had been many years, of course. My memory was unreliable in the best of circumstances, but the thought of her letting go of anything, especially her own life, seemed far-fetched to me. But what did I know about her now? Nothing, really. By choice. I use the brief seconds Matthew is gone to slip my socked feet out of my boots and push them against the awful linoleum as reality shifts and rearranges itself around me. He comes back with a tall, thin glass filled with ice, a slice of lime and water. I take it gratefully, sliding my feet back into my boots. Trying to sip water through too many cubes is a difficult and unwieldy task, and I struggle for a second. But finally the cool liquid gets through, soothing my mouth and throat. He tells me, "The police would like to talk to you." I frown. As I said, I haven't seen her for many years. And then, why are they involved? They have to investigate all deaths where the case isn't cut and dried. Not cut and dried. But what does it have to do with me? I realise as soon as the words are out how awful that must sound. Well, here's the thing. Natasha left a will. I shrug. He smiles. "You're asked to be at the reading." "Now?" He shakes his head. "No, no. Tomorrow." I frown again. Because of the delicate nature of... well, Natasha being a client, I was forced to reveal the contents to the police in light of it. He adds, "She left instructions for them to contact me." And I do smile at that. Natasha bossing people around, even now she's dead. Will reading. I can't get my head around it, and so for probably too long I don't respond. Nor do I respond when he asks if I'll make it. Instead, I ask questions, which get scant answers. I realise he doesn't know much at all. But he does know where it happened, and I'm able to get the details of the location from him, even though he's reluctant to give them. I leave feeling fuzzy, clutching an address in my hand. I'd forced him to go into what little detail he had about what she'd done, how and where. I wasn't surprised by his answers, though I was gently horrified nonetheless. Possible overdose. Burning. Herself. A small dwelling, which she sat down in before she lit the match. I wonder if she was dead before the flames rose to their full glory. Or at least, not conscious. I hope one or the other. Investigation ongoing, no foul play suspected. I suppose they must have investigated Lisa's death then too. I wouldn't know. I'd read about her death on the internet and been rocketed back to the uneasy days of my childhood. She'd killed herself. Drug overdose. I didn't go to a funeral. The past is just that, isn't it? A lot of people who grow up the way we did don't make it. That's a fact. We are often eaten alive years later by addiction, depression, at our own hands. Survivors who... once liberated, can't handle it. The delicious, terrifying freedom. It's a hard thing to come to terms with, a strange place to find yourself. With a shaky, unstable past detached from the reality everyone else knows. I walk and walk. The city is a maze, but I know its streets and I know them well. When we were girls, we used to study maps of the capital. We weren't allowed television or any books, but for some reason, amongst the limited possessions in our dormitory, there was an A to Z of the City of London. Natasha claimed she had lived there as a child and remembered it, though I was never certain that was true. To me, it sounded far enough away from where we were and different enough that I might find, if not happiness, then at least not nothing. I don't have many memories from before Mum and I arrived at the Black House, and details of how we got there were vague and unforthcoming. I learned about my childhood years later, mostly via newspaper and magazine articles. One lurid book with bold red writing plastered across its cover. But back then, before we were gone, us children pieced things together via each other's experiences. Eventually, those dialogues merged and became real in my head. But I know better than to trust my own mind, warped as it was when I was so young and so impressionable. I eventually get to the address Matthew Parsons had scrawled in his twirly, looping hand. It's an allotment. I walk into the small, cordoned-off green areas. Gardens in a city, for those who want a patch of the outdoors. Little lines run between each plot and they are filled with plants and long stalks with things climbing up them. Even this I don't like. I much prefer the steady, man-made reality of concrete and walls and roads. I know nature can be a brutal prison, as only those who have lived in deepest countryside can. Some like it. I often hear my fellow city dwellers talking dreamily of retiring somewhere green and idyllic, not understanding that it can get so dark out there where nature rules that you can't see what's right in front of your face. There is always light in London, from street lamps and buildings. People work around the clock here. I see it then. A shed on one of the larger patches, or what was a shed and now is just a skeletal structure. Iron railings forming a frame that had once held wood. And a body that burned to death. There is yellow tape everywhere, crime scene tape. Though Matthew Parsons assured me there was no crime. No suspected foul play, as he put it. Play seems an odd word to encompass such awful things. Foul play. I assume in this instance he meant murder, hardly a game. Unless it is, of course. My knees feel soft and I pause, resting a hand on a bench. I have come far enough. I can smell the leftovers of what went on here and it's more than I want. More than I can manage. Fizzing, popping, crackling, the smell of smoke stinging my eyes, seeping into my hair. The taste of it thick in the air. I press a hand to my mouth, push my feet into the ground. I'm safe. This is now. I turn slowly and walk out of the awful expanse of greenery, away from the terrible smell of freshly dug earth and burning, back to the solid footing of pavement. The moving cars rushing past, the people everywhere who don't give me a second glance. I feel more at ease as I walk back to my flat, up the stairs, closing the door behind me, pressing my back to it and sinking down. The tears come as I curl my arms and body around my legs. They fall in silent, shoulder-shuddering waves. Chapter 2. I don't eat at home, which had been my intention. I drink a large mug of green tea and then I head into Planet Pop, suddenly desperate to see Isaac. He is there behind the counter. A thin man, naturally so, built with a sort of metabolism that means he can eat cream cakes all day long and look exactly the same. He was once beautiful and still has his good looks now, though they are worn and fading. He looks up at me as I come in and grins. When I don't smile back, he narrows his eyes. Blue? I tell him, in garbled words, hearing myself laugh at one point, I haven't seen her for 20 years. Then, I can't think what the hell she'd have left me. He says, I'll come along. What? To the reading. I say, I don't know if I'm good to go, actually. I'm toying with the idea of forgetting the whole thing ever happened. I can easily block Parson and Rice's number from my phone, tell the police, quite honestly, that I have nothing to say about a ghost from the past. Isaac says, don't be stupid. And now it's my turn to scowl at him. He grins back, and I sigh. Okay. He says, I'll call Oren and tell him he'll be on his own for the afternoon. You think he's ready? Oren was a mess when he first started here, almost 6 months ago now. He'd just done a long term in prison, not his first sentence, but while he was there, his mother had passed away. He'd been unable to attend her funeral. Though he continued to drink and use behind bars initially, after his mum passing, he started attending NA meetings. Isaac ran that meeting, something he'd been doing for as long as I'd known him, which felt like forever. He had told Oren that if he kept clean one day at a time, there'd be a job waiting for him. He'd done well in the 6 months since he'd been out, but we hadn't left him alone yet. Isaac shrugs. I think so. But we'll find out tomorrow, I guess. I nod. This is his way. And I know that if Oren ransacked the place, which wasn't far outside the boundaries of belief, Isaac would accept it. He says, we'll cash up and bank what's there, though, eh? With a wink at me. A morning's takings won't be as tempting as a week's. I nod, not pointing out that we have some rare records worth thousands of pounds. Isaac knows this, but it's his shop. He likes to give people chances, sometimes more than one. I can't argue with that, since I've benefited from it myself over the years. We empty the till, and I count everything, putting it all in the right bags, a task that is second nature now. When I'm done, I hand it to Isaac, who opens the bottom drawer of the till and gets out a thick pinyin book. He doesn't do the internet, and no matter my encouragement and nagging, he absolutely refuses to do online banking. He packs it all in his bag and hands it to me. So call the solicitor and we'll see him tomorrow. I nod. I will. I switch places with Isaac and settle him behind the counter, lowering the seat for my size, feeling the warmth from where he just sat below me and the familiar grooves of the rickety floor beneath my feet. He gets to the door and pauses, head cocked to one side. You all right, kiddo? I swallow thickly and nod. He keeps looking and I shrug. He smiles. I'll be out for the rest of the day, so you lock up. I nod again. Tomorrow then. If you need me before, just call. I will. He leaves with a wave at the door. Chapter 3. I have no idea if I'm supposed to dress up for something like this, and nothing in my wardrobe would class as particularly smart, even if I am. I live in army boots, band t-shirts, and various black jeans in differing stages of frayed decomposition and faded thinness. In the end, I go for the newest pair, a plain black t-shirt and a black blazer with dark sequins around the lapels. One of the best things about working at the shop has been that I've never needed to worry about any kind of dress code. I can come as I like. Isaac turns up outside my flat and parks his rickety VW on my drive. I climb into the passenger side. The day is crisp and bright and I wind down the window. He parks and pays an eye-watering number of coins into a meter. It would have been quicker and definitely cheaper if we'd caught the train, but Isaac abhors public transport with a passion. We walk until eventually the glass building stands before us, a shiny, obnoxious reminder of what's to come, sunlight glinting off its sharp angles. It is with a sigh that I step in, waiting for the lift. At the last minute, a stressed-looking woman, hanging on to wobbling spectacles and yelling, "Hold it! Hold it!" runs towards us, but the doors close despite my manic pressing of the open button. As we step out of the lift onto the first floor, she is there, out of breath and leaning forward, resting her hands on her thighs. She murmurs, "Must give up smoking." Isaac laughs. One of life's great pleasures. She looks at him. Her expression startled, and he gives her his most charming grin. A lot of people recognize Isaac, but can't pinpoint where from. He was in a band who were big in the 70s and 80s. The band split in 1987 after the drummer choked to death in his own vomit. Isaac had a breakdown of sorts, which led him to giving up his long love affair with heroin and getting sober. He bought Planet Pop outright, and people still come from far and wide to see him in the shop. He suffers this with relatively false modesty. I can well imagine him on stage lapping up the adoration. Isaac is still in a recovery program, which he thinks he'll be in for the rest of his life. And a lot of recovering addicts do stints working at Planet Pop. I'm the only long-term member of staff, though. Isaac has two children and an ex-wife who doesn't speak to him. And he has me. He grins at the woman, who doesn't smile back. Unperturbed, he turns to the front desk, walking up to it with his usual confidence. I trot along behind him, the out-of-breath woman with the red hair huffing along too. I realise, feeling increasingly horrified as she pulls a gleaming police badge from her grey, slightly crumpled suit jacket, that she is probably here for the same reading. The receptionist signs her in, then turns her glassy smile to me and Isaac. Before I can stop her or turn and run away, she says, "Oh, Miss Sillitoe, what good timing." My heart sinks as a policewoman turns her bright eyes on me. "Blue Sillitoe?" I stare at her, a deer caught in headlights. She's older than me by maybe 20 years, closer to Isaac's age than mine. And despite the ruffled introduction I got to her and the fact that she's still panting slightly, she looks capable and clever. This shouldn't make me nervous. I've done nothing wrong. But I am intrinsically scared of police. And of teachers. And any form of authority. Nobody could blame me for that. I was bred to believe these people wanted only to harm and hurt me. Logically, I know that's not true. When rescue had eventually come, after bleak hours spent stumbling around the dark woods of North Wales, ashes in our hair and not enough clothes to keep out the freezing night, it had been people in uniforms who had found us, taken us in, to safety and food. The woman puts a hand out, her fingers long and slim. Nice hands with slightly chipped pink nail polish that seems out of keeping with her suit. She smiles. D.I. Grafton. I take her hand, shake it. She pulls mine up, looking at the stars imprinted on the back of it and says, "Cool tat." I nod, pulling it back and tugging down the sleeve of my blazer. It is cool, though. I love the colours that run up and down my right arm, covering a multitude of scars so thickly layered, they give my skin a texture all of its own. The artist I'd seen to do the long sleeve for me had gasped when he saw the state of that arm. I didn't say anything, offered nothing in the way of explanation, just asked if he could help. And he had. It's a triumph. Taking something ugly and giving it its own ferocious beauty. I've been back to see him many times since then, and my body is now a collage of beautiful little surprises. I feel a shudder of annoyance in my bowels. There are so many ways I've moved on. I had a counsellor who'd pushed and pushed at me once until I almost broke. I couldn't handle pain needed to heal in any real way. But I have survived. I manage. I have some kind of life. I am free. And here I am today, dredging up a past I try hard never to think about. I'm about to turn around and tell Isaac I want to go when Matthew appears, grinning from me to D.I. Grafton. Now it's too bloody late. I point to Isaac. "My friends come along," he says, "for support." He grins at Matthew, who forces a smile back and says, "Good idea." I follow them all back through the open plan into the little glass boxes, trailing behind like a naughty child. Matthew smiles at us again once we're all seated. I frown back and glance at D.I. Grafton, whose face is impassive, and Isaac, who looks perfectly at ease. The spectacles the D.I. had been holding clasped to her nose in the foyer and now sweeping back her thick red hair like an Alice band. Matthew Parsons, evidently not used to his charms being ignored, clears his throat, adopting a more serious face now. He says, "We are all here today for the reading of the Will and Testament of Natasha Lydia Dryden." Lydia. Had I known that? We never use surnames, or we weren't supposed to anyway. All of us were known by our Christian names only. Of course, we told each other. But she never mentioned being Lydia. The sound of those letters together makes me think of fluttering butterfly wings, something delicate and urgent. The name, I decide, doesn't suit her at all. Natasha is much better, with its clear syllables and sharp pronunciation. Much more her. Lydia. "Miss Sillitoe, sorry?" Grafton leans into me with a smile that makes her hard face look gentle. Mr. Parsons was just telling us that you were one of two beneficiaries in Natasha's will. I swallow, and it is a thick, gloppy feeling. Then I say, oh, rather pointlessly. The solicitor clears his throat again. I'm reminded of an actor preparing for a performance, getting into character before wowing audiences with beautiful soliloquies. Firstly, there's the matter of money, of which there's rather a lot. There is a large amount due to you. He looks pointedly at me and slides a piece of paper across the table, as though to say the number aloud is somehow tasteless. I look at the amount. It is big. I'm not really sure what the hell I'd do with it. I have everything I need. I blink once, twice, unsure what to say. He smiles at me, a benign expression, and seems to assume I'm gleefully overwhelmed. She was rather savvy with properties and sold several in the year before her. D.I. Grafton says, you oversaw the sales? He nods. I did. More what I do, if I'm honest. Property law? He nods again. The beautiful glass offices, the insane amount it costs to live anywhere in London, money to be made for sure. Less so in this sort of thing, I suppose. When she asked me to oversee her will and testament, well, I could hardly say no. He looks at both of us somberly, though I had no idea it would be needed in the near future. D.I. Grafton smiles. And she remunerated you well, of course, for stepping out of your comfort zone. Work-wise? His skin flushes at that and I suppress a smile. Isaac lets out a little laugh, though, openly enjoying the solicitor's moment of discomfort. So she had paid him to deliver her death messages. And Grafton knew, and wasn't about to let him claim dibs on a charitable act. He says, naturally, ours was a business relationship. No longer smiling. Of course. I say, so all of this money, it's mine, just like that? Not quite just like that, no. There are certain conditions. One in particular. I'm aching with impatience now and almost entirely certain that I'll just say no and be done with the whole affair. D.I. Grafton breaks in then. We also can't release funds to you or make any of her requests entirely permanent until we have a definitive ID. Due to the nature of her remains, identification isn't proving a simple thing. Nature of her remains. I think of blackened, crisp skin and bones burned to a cindery dust. I think of my mother and feel sick. I say, I don't even want the money. I can add Natasha's grave to my visits to Lisa's and regret it all in my own bloody time. Matthew pipes up again. As I said, it's not just about the money. I snap, well? Natasha has had a child. There's a silence then. A pregnant pause with a weight and feel all of its own. A child. Natasha is a mother, like the ants. I push that thought away, a wave of nausea washing over me. No, not like the ants. Hopefully, not like them. But then again, burned, alive, in a shed by her own hand. A girl, I ask, stammering over the words as though they are stuck in my mouth. But I already know with a strong certainty before he says yes, adding Penelope, Pen for short. Penelope, Pen. I draw. It is the only thing I find soothing. It is my talent. I scribble things from my mind onto paper. When I go to visit Lisa's grave, I draw pictures of her, Natasha and I, and leave them there, where presumably the weather, or maybe somebody else takes them. They are my small offerings in lieu of anything better. Pen. The word brings a nice sort of comfort to me. The maker of images and words, filler of blank pages, A good name for a little girl. She wants me to have her. He nods. Said you would hesitate, but expected you'd say yes, ultimately. Then he gets out an envelope, pale pink with my name written in a flouncy flourish, in handwriting unchanged in 20 years. There is a kiss trailing off after the E. X. As though this is a casual note passed during lessons. That nausea again. I feel a wave start in my head, dropping down the length of me into my feet. Isaac asks, "Are you all right?" Then Grafton snaps at Matthew Parsons, "Water." And then, "Bring a mug of sweet tea too." When he is gone, they both turn to me. The detective kneels in front of me, her eyes are green, which is rare in real life. I focus on them now. She says, "This must be a terrible shock." It is. I know about Penn. I thought and had been hoping the will may shed some light on our next moves with her. I didn't know you were specifically named as Natasha's choice of guardian, though I suspected it may be the case. Especially when Mr. Parsons stressed that Natasha had asked for early meetings to be in person. Where? I swallow. Where is she now? She's being looked after. Social services, she nods. How old is she? 10. I see Grafton exchange a look with Isaac, and when I look at Isaac's face, he smiles, but it comes out as a grimace. He mutters, "You okay, Blue?" I shake my head. He takes my hand and squeezes it. I grip his back, my palm pressing into the array of heavy rings, mine clinking against his, a mishmash of decorative hardware. 10 years old. Just like me when everything changed. Alone, unafraid, not knowing where she'll spend tonight or the one after. I hate Natasha in this moment. I hate her deeply. Parsons comes back. With the receptionist falling awkwardly behind, carrying a tray with a wobbling glass of water and a china cup of tea. A man who cannot carry refreshments, who has left such things far behind. Or maybe that's unfair. I don't know. I drink the tea. Parsons starts addressing Isaac and D.I. Grafton instead when it becomes clear that I am beyond taking anything else in. The meeting concludes. There's an awful lot of take your time, and discuss it with someone you trust, with pointed looks at Isaac, punctuated with a contradictory, decisions need to be made, squeezing the idea that I have time far away. We get outside and I am stunned by the brilliant sunshine. Inside I feel dark and stirred up. Isaac is close by and when D.I. Grafton holds a card out to me, I stare at it dumbly. Eventually he takes it. She turns to me, waiting for me to meet her eye. "Blue, I know this must be very surreal for you." I look at her blankly. She says, "You don't need to decide straight away." Which is, of course, a lie. Chapter 4. Annie Grafton walks away from them, her heart pounding and her palms slightly damp. What the hell had he been doing there, of all people? Friend, Blue Sillitoe had said. He surely wasn't her lover. He was old enough to be her dad by a long mile. Then again, aging rock star you never know. He talked a good talk and Annie had even admired him from a distance, of course. But people could say all kind of things, couldn't they? Who knew what was true and what wasn't? If people were honest all the time, she'd have no job. He hadn't acknowledged her, though, and for that she was grateful. She'd seen he recognised her. Everyone always did because of her bloody hair. Shit. Her phone rings and she almost drops it, pulling it from her bag. She picks up with a sharp, "What?" Ian's pitiful voice breaks in. "Happy to hear from me as ever then," she stifles a sigh. "Not at all. I didn't see who was calling. Are you busy?" "I'm always busy." There is a silence that stretches out, immediately filled by her guilt. "Sorry, I didn't mean to snap. Are you okay?" "Not really." She's at her car, and another has parked so close to hers that she struggles to get in.
In the end, she presses her car door against theirs, not caring one bit if she scrapes their paintwork. What an idiotic place to park. Finally, she manages to squeeze herself in and winds down the window. Her aircon has died and she's not had a second to get the bloody thing in for repair. Annie? Sorry, yes, I was getting into my car. You're working? She rolls her eyes, the question making her feel more annoyed than it probably should. I am, yes. Oh, I won't keep you then. This is it, her chance to say, okay, cool, and hang up. Instead, she hears her own voice betraying her. It's okay, Ian. What's up? For 10 minutes, she listens to her soon-to-be ex-husband moan about nothing and everything, gearing himself up to the grand finale. He's received the divorce papers, and isn't it so sad? Not for her. Freedom looms, just out of reach, but very nearly there. She murmurs something non-committal and finally manages to hang up the call. Driving back to the station, Annie thinks about Blue Silito, Natasha Dryden, and the child sitting now at social services offices while her future is determined. Her connection to Isaac doesn't matter, she decides. It's tenuous at best, and will have no impact on her ability to handle a case. She wonders whether she has time to stop and grab a coffee, and heads towards the drive-through Costa, praying that there isn't a long queue. Hopefully, by tomorrow, Blue will decide what to do about Penelope Dryden, and if the kid needs to stay in care, Annie will sort it out then. Not much more she can do today. She beeps at an idiot in a large Audi who is clearly trying to kill her. He gives her the finger, which she sends straight back. She considers pulling him over, flashing her badge, but it's between that and Costa time-wise, and the coffee wins. Chapter 5. We make our way back to Isaac's car and get in. He doesn't speak, fiddling instead with the CD player until crooning country music fills the space. His unlikely love of soulful hillbilly ballads has always amused me, and it calms me a bit. He doesn't push me, and I'm grateful because I have no idea what I feel, let alone trying to formulate it into words just yet. I sit quietly looking out of the window. Time is a funny thing. At the Black House, we were woken every single day at 5 on the dot by an alarm that sounded for 3 whole minutes. It was loud and blaring enough that you couldn't go back to sleep even if you wanted to. Our days were odd. They were either overly structured or we were simply left to our own devices. There was no in-between, no balance. What later became apparent was that Joseph Carillo suffered from severe mania, and the periods of overstuffed activity coincided with his up cycles. All the children of the Black House were housed in dorms. I shared with Natasha, Amy and Lisa. They were the closest thing I had to family and I loved them fiercely. My mother and I had come to the Black House shortly after my 5th birthday. It was to be the last one I celebrated, until a well-meaning foster family tentatively tried to spoil me on my 11th. It didn't turn out brilliantly. I don't think I'd ever felt as acutely embarrassed as I had sitting at their kitchen table, surrounded by their actual children, while they brought out a cake and sang. We pull up outside of my flat and Isaac turns to me. He doesn't speak, but he does turn the CD off, kill the engine, and looks at me with his intense eyes. I say, I'm terrible with kids. He shrugs, how do you know? What the hell, Isaac? My voice is high and incredulous. You can't possibly think this is a good idea. He says, it only really matters what you think. I glance down at the envelope in my hand, which I've been clasping so tightly my knuckles look almost black beneath my pale white skin, like lychee stones pushing at the pulp. I half whisper, I can barely look after myself. Still looking at my hands. He takes my chin between his thumb and forefinger, turning my head to look at him. You, Blue, can indeed look after yourself. You've done it beautifully so far. You can, in fact, do anything you put your mind to. Tears prick my eyes. He says, do you remember when you started coming into Planet Pop? I nod. You were so fragile and so cross. I say, you can see why. He holds a hand up. Come on now. No need to be defensive. This is me. He's right. I love Isaac. Something I believe myself to be incapable in the brief years between leaving the Black House and meeting him. He says, you've got less cross. I laugh, but he doesn't. Anger isn't your natural disposition, Blue, and neither is shirking away from things that are challenging. You are a survivor, not a victim. I nod. He has said this to me so many times before, and it's a mantra that I repeat to myself when I need strength. Carillo stole from the people he recruited, but I have vowed not to let him steal the rest of my life. Though I am sore with the past still, there are little bits within me that, if pressed, will bleed out all that pain, all that anger. Justified, hot, and doing me no good. I think about my mother and how much I loved her, how much I hated her, how strongly I felt she had betrayed the trust of a child. I think about the frightened little girl left waiting, not knowing where she'll sleep tonight. I think about flames and fire and Natasha. God damn her. He says, think on this. Give yourself a few hours. Go into your beautiful flat that you made so all by yourself. Read the letter. I sigh, but nod. I don't go into my beautiful flat, though. Instead, I watch him drive away, a small swell of dust spurting up behind the spinning wheels of his car. Then I turn and walk. I propel myself forwards without really being aware of my surroundings. I hear the dull background noise of cars. My eyes flick to an empty billboard covered each day in new graffiti. Some good, some awful. The latest, an explicit word in red, dripping paint. Eventually, I arrive at the gates of the cemetery and head in. It's not cold today, but it's not bright either. I find that I am sweating and wipe a hand across my face, pressing my fingers to my eyes, forming floating black spots when I release the pressure. There are a few other people around here, quietly going about their business, and the gardener is doing his usual rounds. He nods at me, and I nod back as I worm my way through headstones. Eventually, I come to hers. I sit down amongst the cluster where she is buried. Hers is one of the newer additions, and it stands steadfast, straight up and proud, not like the others, which are old and worn and sticking out of the ground at wonky angles, crooked with age, like separated adolescent teeth in need of a good scrub and a brace. The sketch I drew on my last visit is still here, held down by a large grey rock. A pencil rendition of her face peeking out from beneath. I have it in my mind that I can no longer remember what she looked like. It's probably not true, but I don't want to forget either way. The only time I really let myself think about then is when I'm here, next to Lisa. I think of that place, the people in it. I think of my mother. Most people have pictures, don't they, of their childhoods? Proud documentation shoved dutifully into bursting albums or framed and placed on available surfaces, ready to be paraded out to strangers and visitors, big events marked. I suppose those would include, but not be limited to, things like first birthdays, first days at school, graduations, marriages. I have a couple of Polaroids and a random photo of my mother holding me as a newborn. You can hardly see my face for all the blankets, and she is young in the image. Too young. Her smile uneven and unsure, hair stretching towards her waist, bangles sinking up to the crook of her arm where I'm nestled. I don't know who took that photo, though I've pondered it a lot over the years. Wish that before she died, we'd had the kind of relationship where I could have asked. I don't suppose it matters. She gave me that picture before everything went to shit. I'd spent months with it, always in the pocket of whatever I was wearing at the time, or it would have gone up in flames with everything else. Now it is tucked away in a box in my flat. Some days I talk to Lisa, down there under the mud in a box, likely little more than dust by now. Today I should have loads to fill her in on, and yet my mind is peculiarly blank, but for the envelope clutched in my hand. That is why I'm here, to share the burden of this moment with another. I don't like to offload on her, though. I always think she had enough of that in her life. I should have spoken to her while she was still here. This is the same pointless thought I have at every visit. She found me online and reached out more than once, and I ignored her every time. I slide my finger into a corner of the envelope and pull out a single sheet of paper and three photographs. Dear Blue, if you're reading this, I'm gone, and my smarmy solicitor will have outlined what I am asking of you. It's a biggie, and if there was any other way, I'd have found it. But this is how it has to be, and I'm sorry. I know you've built a life for yourself, and I'm proud of you. Lisa and Amy would have been too. Three of us made it to London, which is better than none, eh? I found out you were sent here straight after. I went to Cardiff. Lisa went to Bristol. Maybe you already know that, maybe not. Lisa told me she wrote and wrote, and we talked a few times about just showing up, surprising you. I thought you wouldn't have wanted that, any more than you probably want this, so again, I'm sorry. If there was any other way, I'd have found it. Brody and Drippy Nanny are still in Wales, did you know that? They don't know about Penn, no one does. I've made it clear in the documents Parsons has that they are unsuitable, though I doubt I needed to. They're unlikely to even be a consideration. You may want to contact them, though I don't know what good it will do. I know you visit Lisa often. I've seen the pictures you leave there. I'm pleased about that. I hate the thought of her being left alone. I knew you, Blue. We knew each other more than most people ever do, or maybe more than people ever should. But you were little then. I hope I still understand you a bit. If you're who I think you are, you won't let her down. I've enclosed some pictures. She doesn't look like me, really. I see Nanny in her sometimes, but luckily she has a stronger way about her. She's a tough little cookie. Just like you. The last one standing. N. Kiss, kiss. Chapter 6. 5 a.m. My eyes snap open, my whole body coming to with a long gasp. I push out a hand, scrabbling for the letter that says so little and still too much. Picking up the photographs that came along with it, I can imagine Natasha carefully selecting them, putting them into an envelope, knowing how I would react. Because she did still know me. The pictures show a smiling, toothy little girl. She does look a bit like Natasha's mother, Sienna, known by us as Aunt, because that's how all adult females were to be addressed, or Drippy Nanny behind her back, so nicknamed by her own daughter. But the girl has a spark, even in a still image, the kind that I never saw in Sienna. None of the aunts were exactly vibrant by the end, though I suspect they once were. Certainly my mother had been. It wasn't just the passage of time that had dulled them. Most were very young women still, even by the end. My memories of my mother at the Black House were of an old woman, but she hadn't even turned 30 when she burned alive. I had a sort of understanding that we were eventually expected to somehow morph into them, the aunts, with their dour expressions, faces drawn and serious, their long white dresses, a parody of that worn by hippie brides everywhere, and their sandaled feet. In all weather, they had bare legs and open-toed shoes, and out there it did turn freezing. I couldn't understand how that could be, that we would one day be them. The women at the Black House weren't women. They were ghosts. Faint whispers of things that used to be. I had memories of my mother laughing, singing, cooking, beautiful in her long floor-length colourful skirts and jingly-jangly bracelets. Admittedly, I saw less and less of her during my 5 years there. But what I did see when she stood at the front of the classroom or ladled out food to the long queue of always hungry children was a robot. We hadn't been like that as girls. Maybe Amy had been heading in that direction by the end, but not me or Lisa. And Natasha was so brimming with life that it could be overwhelming. Natasha. Suicide. I couldn't get it out of my head. Why? The little girl in the picture looks like she has inherited her mother's spark, grinning broadly directly at the camera, reassuring me that I'm not making it up, not fabricating it. How many nights will it take in foster homes for that shine to wear off? Would nights with me be any better? My life is little in some ways, but I like it. It is safe and has love in it, something I could have only dreamed of way back when. I have Isaac, and lately I'd say I also have Oren. I enjoy my friendships with them, Isaac especially, who I would be lost without. I like my interactions with customers, surface mostly, but built on a shared interest which makes conversation easy enough. Which is your favourite Pistols song? When was grunge at its finest? Why are all the great music movements so brief? These are discussions I can have and manage. Friendships are hard when you have a past like mine, and romantic relationships are more hassle than I can bear. I dated very briefly in my early 20s, but having to constantly skirt questions about my family, my childhood, where I grew up is exhausting. There is the boy I think of often and wonder how he has done, if he is okay. My last memory of him, of us, walking, me wounded, through the dark wood. We'd stood at the edge of it, bedraggled and disorientated. Natasha had stepped away from me and he'd let go of his mother just for a moment, come to me and held my good hand in his voice telling me that it would all be all.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.